Hey everyone, what's going on? This is Ash and Rima from MEOdyssey, and today we have a very special video for you all. Today we have been kindly joined by the voice of Sara Ryder in Mass Effect Andromeda. We have Fryda Wolff with us. Fryda, how are you?
Oh, hello. Greetings from space in the future.
Yes, greetings from 600 years away.
Oh, dear. In Andromeda Galaxy.
So the one kind of question I want to start off with, because it's only as strange as it sounds making so many videos and for you probably recording hours upon hours of lines in a VO booth somewhere, it's only been like a few weeks since N7 Day and you were announced as Sara Ryder. I think I'm pretty sure, Rima, correct me if I'm wrong, that the first announcement we saw was you, Tom, and the voice of Dad Ryder being announced.
Clancy Brennan, yeah.
Yes, I think you were the very first announcement that came up on N7 Day. But since that's kind of happened, you've had a few weeks to digest the fact that you're now known as Sara Ryder. How has that been in the last few weeks? Yes.
Yeah, no.
That's wonderfully ominous. I am known.
You are known. But how's that kind of last few weeks been since it's been announced? You've had time to kind of digest everything and the game kind of slowly moving towards release. Yes.
I knew what I was getting into, but I was really in denial of it for a long time. I mean, I did my first community interview yesterday with Kodak, and he asked, so what was it like when you found out? And I was like, well, the way my brain processed it was voice actors, especially when it comes to video games, because we can't have nice things and people have gone as far as to leak like full scripts to websites to feel cool. I don't know why. But that happens often enough with games where we very often don't know what we're auditioning for. And when we book something, we don't know what we're working on either. We're just told a time and a date and a studio to go to and show up. And you're like, okay. And it was the same thing with Andromeda, and just Caroline Livingstone just told me then there, she, you know, there's no client there. She Skypes and she's like, hey, so welcome to Mass Effect. You're the player character. Okay, let's get started. And I was like, what? Like, she didn't give me 5 seconds. Also, like, time is money, right? Like, the session is paid for, the studio time is running, so we just got to get to work. And that's fair enough, because if we sat there and, like, let me do my Miss America beauty pageant meltdown, that's a waste of everyone's time, right? And the way I compartmentalized it was like, you know what? I misheard it. There's no way. It's probably, you know what? She probably meant that I'm the temp VO, because this happens all the time, too. I must be, like, the temp VO, that they just need to get lines recorded to test scripts and just, like, test pipeline. There's no way. There's no way they're hiring, like, me. Right. Okay. And I just told myself that for months, and I think maybe around month 6 or 8, I was like, well, maybe it is me. I don't know. Maybe? No. But no, I was bracing for impact because the Mass Effect community is known as much as I am, you know, as much as the protagonists and stuff are known for, I mean, like I've said online, it's just constantly pleasantly surprising. Y'all are nice and nice because, the majority of online communities, when you think about it, so someone who's busy enjoying themselves and enjoying a product is having too much fun to be online to talk about it. And then the people who are not having a good time and want to talk about how they're not having a good time are pouring all their time and energy and frustration into being angry online. Mm-hmm. So to have that much energy being put into being positive and nice is really weird and rare in games. So I knew I had a brace for impact, and I just kind of been saying, I think I'm enjoying my last few moments of anonymity. and enjoying that while it lasts. But it really hasn't been that bad. Like, I feel like my Twitter follower count isn't in the tens of thousands, so I can still be interactive and attentive with the community. So I'm still trying to make time and energy to talk to people online while I can, and it's totally manageable. Like, it's crazy. I think also just everybody who's into Mass Effect is also on ecstasy all the time, because the emotions are super intense. Y'all run very hot, and everything's just like, I love this, and I love this. Oh, let me touch your face, which is great. It's still totally manageable for me. So, you know, thanks for letting me be a part of your intensely intense world. I mean, also for me, like I've mentioned, like I have, like anybody, I have friends that are obsessed with Mass Effect, like friends in the games industry and out of the games industry. One, my friend Jackie has a freaking tattoo of the last main ship from the last franchise on her arm. And wow. another girlfriend who's an artist, I think at Capcom, is just going off about, like, I really like the Sen7 jacket, but I need more pockets. And I'm just, like, looking at this online going, like, these are my friends. And I really hope they don't hate me after I ruin their franchise. Yeah, so that's been my month since Sen7.
Nice. Oh. Well, another question, because I know I'm doing some research before coming into today. I know that you didn't actually start in VO work in the gaming industry. I believe you started in customer service.
Yeah, I was a game master for EverQuest, which is like now painfully before many gamers were born. but I had the good fortune of, I knew, I only did a year and a half of political science in university, and I wanted to be a political campaign manager, which is really funny if you meet me because I have, you know, facial piercings and colored hair, whatever. But I thought I'd be really good at presenting and selling a product, when if you're in politics, your product is a person. And then at some point I thought, well, maybe I should do PR and marketing for games. And I got my foot in the door with Sony Online. I was 18. They let me intern in PR and marketing right away, and in the first 6 months of employment, which was great and also terrible, because at the time, I mean, this is 2001, the majority of their particular marketing department, all the women, weren't gamers. They were very much there to do like the traditional PR marketing job. They came from flat backgrounds where they'd previously sold toothpaste or whatever. So they weren't really invested. I mean, now if you go through publishers and developers, there tends to be a much higher constituency of people who are personally, emotionally invested. Like, they're gamers themselves. They've worked at other game companies. They care about the games that they're pushing, and they can talk about it ad nauseum because they actually bother playing. But I mean, at that time in the early 2000s, Nah. So it was really disheartening for me, because all the dudes in the department were playing Medal of Honor and didn't care. I mean, Sony Online was the EverQuest company. Like, that was the main product, and followed by PlanetSide and the Star Wars Galaxy. So like MMOs and community building and this new concept of, you know, simultaneous online play on save servers with like world server events, they didn't care. And the women weren't invested either. So it just sort of kind of had me floating in space, and I didn't know what to do with myself in the games industry other than, well, I still want to be in the games industry. So I hung out in customer service for 2.5 years, and then I became a tech VP's assistant for a year. And he was just like, I don't know what to do with you because you're obviously being wasted here. I was like, I know. I don't know either. Because I didn't, in games, I mean, now we're in a very different space. Back in my day, I'm the last generation that could get away with learning trial by fire on the job, because it's only recently that you can, if you want to, you can make a game regardless of your, if you have an internet connection and a computer that can handle it, you can download Unity for free. Unreal recently went free. You can actually get your hands on licenses that used to cost, I mean, Unity excluded because it's new, but used to cost tens of thousands of dollars out the gate before you've ever even made a dime on a product that you haven't made yet.
Yes.
So if you want to learn how to make games, you had to do it at a game company. So it was a total catch-22. Now you've got all these college programs and vocational school programs and art institutes and all this crap. This didn't exist when, you know, I was young. So you kind of got your foot in the door and then figured out later. So a lot of people would get, traditionally they get their foot in the door with customer service, technical support, or QA, and then graduate out of that through opportunities and internships to become a designer, a coder, an artist. Well, I don't like looking at scripts. I never wanted to be a coder. I have strong design opinions, but I don't have strong design ideas, and I can't even write my name, never mind do art. So I was like, I don't know. And I'd actually wanted to be a recording engineer. I'd look into programs when I was still in high school, but again, like, this is early internet. College websites weren't very good. All the stuff that I could get my hands on showed that recording engineer degrees, like, American universities are stupid. They're not stupid. They're all businesses. It doesn't matter if it's publicly funded, like a state college or a private college. They are businesses that are there to maintain a profit, not really to educate the public at large. So as a result, unlike universities, say, in Europe, here you're required to take general education classes that have nothing to do with your major, but you're required to take them so they can make money. So if you want to be if you want to be a science major, you still have to take English lit. If you want to be an English major, you still have to take math classes. It doesn't matter if you're proficient or not in these classes. And of course, they can fail you to prevent you from getting your degree. So you have to pay more money to take the classes again. So all the recording engineering programs I looked at required higher level credits of math and science. And I was like, oh, this is not going to work out for me. So I gave up at 18. And 3 years into being at Sony Online, they started making EverQuest 2, which at the time was the most ambitious project for line count. They were aiming for at least 100,000 lines of dialogue. Everybody in LA recorded. And they needed an entry-level grunt just to implement VO. And I applied for it and got it. And so they had not had an internal audio department before that project. The audio department was founded just to support EverQuest 2. EverQuest and all previous projects were supported with contract audio that was thrown over the wall and implemented in-house by designers and programmers, where the audio people had nothing to do with it. So now I was finally in-house, and I got to do VO implementation for most of the project. And then when the project shipped, I was nervous. There wasn't anything to do. And a lead audio, as it happens for a lot of people, was generous enough to mentor me and give me an opportunity to become a sound designer. So I ended up being a sound designer for the majority of my career. And then that segues really naturally into VO, because everybody who works in audio knows you get really comfortable behind the mic. First of all, there's a lot of audio people who either come from a recording background or they're musicians, they've been in bands, whatever. So the concept of audio chains and recording and mic technique is there already. But also you get thrown in the booth a lot in games just to do temporary VO or to do creature sounds or whatever. So you don't really think about it as like maybe people first time behind the mic get really self-conscious or whatever. If you're in audio, you're doing this every day and you're not thinking twice about it. And then also sometimes in game audio, when you're a sound designer, you're also privy to casting and scheduling and budgeting and getting contracts approved and being present during VO sessions, which I was. So all of this was training to become a voice actor without it being training to be a voice actor, if that makes sense.
Without you knowing,
It's a completely organic lateral move for me to go from game audio to VO. So, and then I get accused a lot of, well, you're booking in games because you know people from games. Actually, my friends still make me audition if they want me to do something. The grand majority of the time, I'm just keeping up with the hamster wheel of auditions that come in through my agency. You know, so like I work all day doing VO. I come home, I have to do auditions that night that come in through my agency. And everyone in town who has an agent is getting these same auditions. We're all competing the same time over and over again for the same jobs. You can guarantee that for like if I get a part for a female in a game in LA, at least 250 women are going to be auditioning for it that night.
Yeah.
My friends who have known me since I was 18 will still be like, hey, I think you'd be good for this. Here's an audition. And my job is to say thank you for the opportunity, but they're in no way obligated to hire me, and they don't always. So that's pretty much how I ended up here on this side. So it might seem like, you know, I came from nowhere, but there's a pretty common saying in show business Hollywood. It's like you're an overnight success after 10 years.
Yeah.
Like the joke is that everybody who ends up suddenly arriving, quote, out of nowhere, they've been here the whole time. It's just not every role you get is something with a high profile like Mass Effect, for example.
Yeah. Before Rima asks her next question, you mentioned about the codec guys that you spoke to yesterday. We've actually worked with them a few times before in a few collaborations, and I was watching part of the interview that you did yesterday with them there as well. And I found it interesting hearing that you've not actually been in kind of full-time voice acting that long, about 4 years, if I'm not mistaken.
It'll be 4 years in April, and I make my anniversary when I signed with an agency, because I've been doing VO before, like doing VO for money, like by my account. And you're a professional when people are paying you to do the thing, whatever the thing is. It's like, okay, well, you're a professional because someone thinks you're worth paying for. And at this day and age, with the internet, if you have a decent setup and you have internet access, there are limitless websites out there where you can make a profile, and then people usually posting non-union projects are booking for whatever, from student level all the way to like national campaigns at a non-union buyout, meaning that, you know, it's not going through like a SAG after contract. It's going through, well, we're paying you this to compensate for the fact that we don't want to deal with the union paperwork. Hmm. And that's fine, but it's kind of the Wild West. If you're not, an agent's purpose is to negotiate schedule and rates and just make sure that you're protected. You're on your own on the internet. For me, I knew what I was doing and I knew I wasn't being paid properly, but it was on purpose because it's like, well, you're getting what you pay for. I'm willing to sacrifice profit to gain experience. And you're obviously willing to sacrifice quality because you're hiring random people off the internet. So yeah. Everybody wins.
Yeah.
So I was doing that. The first time I accepted money for VO was 2009. And I still have that contract. It's for an internal, it's for their in-house voice system. It's thank you for calling the Costco auto program. If you'd like to speak to a representative. That was the first, and that was like a friend through goth club. Like, so back in the day, I'm old guys. In San Diego, when you went to goth club, everybody who went to goth club either worked at Qualcomm, which is a local tech comm company, or worked at Sony Online. I swear to God, like everybody in black with their nail polish and their black hair dye was a dork for a day job. And we all knew each other because the community was really small. So a girlfriend of mine who worked at Qualcomm, who knew I worked at Sony Online, was like, and then again, this happens a lot in audio. Like, it's presumed the audio guy, which of course is gender bullshit, should be the audio person. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. When it's like, you're in audio, right? So that means you do sound effects, music, VO, composition, everything. Audio people are trained to just say, yeah, even though they haven't before, because it's like, I'll figure it out when I get there. That is to say, people in audio tend to be, nobody is great at everything because you're not Leonardo da Vinci. Sorry, but deal with it. but when you, especially like if you serve a smaller studio with a smaller budget, you may be expected to wear several hats. So it is pretty common for an audio person at a company to be the composer, as well as the sound designer, as well as the general audio director, as well as the VO producer. When you work at a bigger company with a bigger staff and a bigger budget, those jobs tend to be divided and compartmentalized to individuals. But sometimes you have to wear all hats. So my girlfriend adorably is like, you're in audio. That means you do VO, right? And I was like, yeah. and like, lucky for me that I actually, you know, so I was had some semi-competence to do it. So I've been doing that contract since 2009. It's still ongoing to the point where the guy who originally hired me has since died of cancer. And that's when I know I'm long in the tooth. but yeah, so that's when I started. That's also like when the needle went in of like, oh, people will pay me for this? Huh. And that's when I started going to L.A. from Orange County nights and weekends, just to casually as a hobby take VO classes and improv classes for fun, because me being in game audio, I was still privy to co-directing VO sessions and stuff, and I just thought it would probably behoove me to understand what I'm asking actors to do. And that served me very well because I never had the pressure on me of like, when you're an actor that gets off the bus from somewhere in the Midwest and you show up in LA and you do that typical LA story of being a struggling actor, the pressure to succeed is so tremendous that desperation is probably bleeding into your performance and your auditions and actually preventing you from getting work. It is exactly like when you go dating and you're desperate, nobody wants you because you're gross and you're desperate and need for love. And that just, it stinks off of you. You know, people are dogs. They can smell fear and neediness and all that stuff. Versus, if you walk into a room, you're like, yeah, I mean, I don't really need this, but if y'all want me, I'll give you 5 minutes of my time, sure. And you walk out and everybody wants you. So I had this luxury of having a full-time job and then doing VO-related stuff nights and weekends as a hobby. It didn't have to make me money. So when I rolled over, I was like, I think I already know what I'm doing. Whoa, okay. Yeah, I think I know what I'm doing. So it was a much more natural transition, and also I just didn't have all that psychological stuff bogging me down.
Yeah.
So I forgot the original question. I'm really
that's okay. No, that's absolutely fine. Rima actually had the next question. Yeah. So yeah.
Yeah, that's my next one. Well, it's kind of related to kind of what you've been talking about, but has there been any kind of like interesting stories or like tales from your adventures as a voice actor? Like anything funny that's kind of happened to you while you've been going about, you know, because I imagine it's quite an interesting world, but we have no experience in it whatsoever. So it would be nice to know if there was anything just kind of quirky that happened to you at some point?
Well, the fun thing for me now is, like, the way I mentioned that in animation and commercials and stuff, you know exactly, you get your script before, you know who you're working with. Like, there's no surprises. In games, everything's a surprise. So what's happened a few times is, like, I walk into a room and, like, a former boss is there and I'm like, oh, hi. What? And it's, like, a really nice, funny reunion because I was in game dev for so long, people have literally watched me grow up. I mean, I started when I was 18. I'm 34 now. So people have watched me through my relationships. I've seen them through their relationships and all their company changes. So it's like, it's really kind of like nice and emotional to kind of circle around and be able to still work and serve that community, but in the capacity where they're riding my ass because I'm the actor and now they're the client with the whip, which is really funny. So that's happened a few times. That's just like really nice and rewarding to see people that I used to work for in a different context. And it's nice for them too, because they only knew me as like the sound designer person, but still loud. And now I'm just loud for money. So, so that's happened a few times. And other than that, it's just, I had to learn how to play it cool very quickly. So when you're in LA, seeing celebrities in the first place is like, it stops being exciting really quickly because people just live and work here. This is the actor factory. So it kind of loses its tourism sparkle pretty quickly because people just got to go to the grocery store at, 9 at night or whatever and get toilet paper. So I had to start playing it cool really quickly. Yeah.
I was going to say, who was the most famous person you saw buying toilet paper? Because that's the next question it has to be.
One time I walked behind Misha Barton at a supermarket, and she's an American starlet, and it was just funny because it was the middle of the night, but she still had to be in a fur coat because that's Hollywood. The thing is, like I said, with animation commercials, for example, I know exactly what I'm doing and who I'm doing it for. I don't necessarily know who I'm doing it with. I don't always know if it's going to be an ensemble recording, so with the other actors in the episode or the scene or whatever. And I don't know who those characters are going to be played by. So a few times now I've gone in to do, I'm in a few animated series, which I can't mention yet because animation takes like the one thing that's on my IMDb. The one thing that's on my IMDb is DC Super Friends, which is all on YouTube. Mm-hmm. And I got to be Poison Ivy. That was like a year and a half from recording to coming out. So you just learn to forget what you did. So it's a nice surprise when it finally comes out. So you're just not like champion of being like, where's the thing that I'm in? So I'm in a few things, and a few times I get there and there's like a film or TV actor, and they're always like somebody that I grew up watching, and I'm gonna be in the room with them working for 4 hours. You cannot have your tail wagging and be like, oh my god, because your performance is gonna suck. Like your focus is all broken if you're busy trying to impress or get the attention of or adulate someone you admire. Like, it's a waste of everyone's time, so you have to shut that down really, really quickly. So I've just learned to be like, sup, cool, nice to meet you. Even if I'm dying inside, it doesn't matter because I'm there to do work. Mm-hmm. But also I've learned, so like our sessions can be broken up to at the most to do like 2 4-hour sessions a day, because you're not probably going to be at the same studio, so you need like an hour of driving time in LA to cross town, right? And that means if you do a 9 a.m. to 1 p.m., and then your next session is 2 to 6, you got to eat at some point. And I've learned to give up on trying to buy an actual edible lunch and then eat it before the next thing, because there's just no time between driving and eating. The last time I show up at the studio, I'm going to do a cartoon, and then someone I grew up with, I tweeted this just because I needed to shame myself. Now I just eat Liquid Hipster, which is Soylent. It takes three ground up hipsters per bottle. Just tastes like white male problems. I show up. I've had just enough time to get a coffee and a BLT from a cafe I like, and I'm trying to shove this sandwich in my mouth in the last 7 minutes before. And then this guy from a TV show I grew up with, who's very handsome, walks in. He's like, "Hi, I'm Steven." And I'm like, "Hi, I have BLT hands." And you just, yeah. So that's. That's working in LA though. You have to learn to stop being excited so that the work isn't garbage. It's a weird catch-22. Like, you can go home and be excited and be like, oh my God, I worked with so-and-so today. But you also can't get the reputation of being the person that fangirls out every time you're asked to, go toe-to-toe with someone who you know of or are a fan of.
Fair enough.
Yeah. Another one I, because a couple of mine you've kind of already answered, so I'm going to leave them behind. But another one, and it's a lot, it's a question that we got a lot in the video that we put up a week or two ago. And a lot of them were like, oh, how do you get started in voice acting? But you've obviously already kind of explained that. So I've kind of reworded the question slightly. What are the three most crucial bits of advice you can give someone who wants to start in a VO career? Because I've been on your website and I've seen the bit where it says how to become a voice actor, and there is, pardon my Britishness here, but there's a crap ton of information on your website, purely just on like how to start up, like who to contact, agencies, videos, YouTube channels, all that kind of stuff. And it's just a goldmine of information for anyone who's interested in doing it. But what are the three most crucial bits of advice you can give anyone and people who asked us who want to start a VO career?
So number one is Google. Like before you ask how to anything, any career to any person, because the second you go, like you think, I want to be an engineer, and then you find an engineer and you send them. I had to make that tab on my website because I've lost count of how many times I've gotten the, could you talk to my coworker, my friend's son? Could you talk to my college age niece, blah, 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 about how to? And I'm like, did they Google? Did they read anything? Did they make any effort whatsoever? Because if you're looking for a shortcut, there never is one. And especially if you're going into something that is not an A to B to C, meaning like you have to go to college, get a degree, get an internship, like there's not a set, or like if you want to be an electrician, you have to be a journeyman and then like an apprentice and then a journeyman, and there's like a union standard. If there's no set in stone A to B, your path will not resemble anyone else's, because that's just how it works. It doesn't. So the very first thing you need to do is Google and read as much as you can. Because the second you ask someone, how did you get your job? You're already going to be dismissed as being lazy and incompetent because you can't be arsed to do the work yourself. Yeah. That's number one. Number two, actually read the stuff. I mean, I put everything on that tab because there is an overwhelming wealth of information. People have exhausted themselves writing books and selling themselves online for classes, either in person or on Skype. Like, I mean, I didn't receive newsletters in the mail bundled with like supermarket coupons. Also, this is where you can get VO classes. I bothered looking. I happened to, like, for example, Richard Horvitz, who was the voice of Invader Zim and what's his face on Psychonauts and the villain in Skylanders and all this stuff, who has just like a tremendous career in games and animation. I'm a fan of him just as his work. So I bothered Googling, and right there on his website, he's like, I teach classes. Brilliant. Take my money. and he ended up doing my first round of demos, for example. Mm-hmm. So number one, Google. Two, actually just like if you are obsessed, you will make it. So you have to absorb and just go through as much. Also, like the more material you ingest, the more you'll realize what is worthwhile information and what is garbage. Because the world is thrilled to take your money as long as you want to give it. No one, especially if you work in a creative field, no one's going to give you a certificate and say, you are ready to do this for a living now. You are a professional now. You have completed this course of becoming a grown-up. Nobody does that. You have to decide for yourself, okay, I'm ready to be taken seriously. I'm a professional. Like some of the best of advice I got from Stephanie Shea, who's another voice actor, she's like, no one's going to treat you like a professional until you do. Until you treat yourself as a professional, essentially. Mm-hmm. Which is, it's ridiculous that you have to be told that, but a lot of people still do have to be told that you establish when you are ready. So that's another thing. Like you can be Googling and immersing yourself in education forever and just like throwing your money away. But those people would love to have you in a holding pattern forever, giving your money away. So you have to decide for yourself.
Yeah.
And I think the third is probably just doing it, which is really vague, but you got to get your hands dirty and do trial by fire. You will not know if a job's sustainable or if you'll even like doing it until you're doing it. And that is at any level. So like, for example, if you want to be a stand-up comic, you throw yourself into the fire pit and start going to open mic nights when you suck, when you know you're terrible, when you're going to be embarrassed and not want to do it again. But there's no other way of knowing if you want to do that for a living. So with VO, this is tricky with VO specifically though. So first impressions really last. And if you put yourself out there where you're showing up for auditions and things before you're fully cooked, before you're ready, people will remember that. And they'll remember, oh, this person's not competent or not competent yet or probably possibly competent never. So you want to make sure that you have the experience and the work under your belt of classes. Maybe doing improv is the number one thing that I push on people who want to do VO, because you're taught to think on your feet, be reactive, but also be supportive of other people in your scene, which is incredibly important when you're doing VO. You're not there to kind of block yourself off and obsess about, okay, what do I want my voice to sound like? So what's going on with me? This is about me. When you're in a room with other people, your job in improv, I mean, you're told this no matter what improv school you go to, your job is to make the other people in your scene look good. It's not about you. And if everybody follows that, everybody looks good. Versus if you're like, wait, what am I going to say next? No, these are my ideas. And you push everyone else's ideas aside because you want to be the show pony. It's going to go badly for you. And people will remember that and not hire you. So just do it and then commit to VO when you are well and truly ready. But again, you have to decide that for you, because everyone would be happy to keep the siphon on the money machine on.
Yeah. So. I think kind of going along that, I think in the gaming industry in general, I think a lot of people think, yeah, I'm going to go make games and yeah, I'm going to get into it really easy. Maybe kind of back in 2001, like you're saying, but these days so many people are looking for like qualifications and all stuff like that. It's so oversaturated. And I think probably the only similar way to what you were discussing previously just there is maybe just going in as a games tester. That's probably one of the only kind of entry points I know of that you can still get in and just apply, get in there and then kind of work your way up kind of thing. And I might be wrong now. So,
well, I mean, that used to be traditional. Traditionally what you did is like, okay, I'm just going to get my foot in the door and, you know, see it from the ground up, which by the way, I do still think that most, for example, I think some of the best film directors are directors that come from different vocations where they worked on other people's films in some capacity, because they know exactly what the production is. They're not just a person who's always sat in the director chair and ordered people around when they don't know what they're telling people to do.
Yeah.
So it's the same thing. If you become a creative director of a game or a game company, it behooves you to have worked in some vocational part of the pipeline, so you know what you're actually asking people to do. So that's extremely important. So with games, though, you have the accessibility for any number of engines to actually make something in Scratch. It may not be great, but I mean, like, that's the story of Octodad. Octodad was originally their final exam project to graduate from DePaul University in Chicago. And it had such success just as a student project. 9 of the 12 original students stuck together, incorporated, and then did a do-over, and that's the Octodad that shipped.
Cool. I love that game.
Yeah, yeah, it's very cute.
Controls are a bit, yeah, but I think they're supposed to be.
That's so. The idea.
Yeah.
That's the idea. Octodad,
I got frustrated.
People who played Octodad just like divvied into two people, either people who got the joke or people who didn't. And people who didn't, like, oh, these controls are wanky. I can't do anything. I keep slapping my family in the face. And then other people are, you know, like in hysterics and tears, giving themselves the hiccups because they're laughing at how ridiculous the whole thing is. So it was just like, it's so funny how polarizing that game is. I mean, the poor Octodad suffered in Metacritic with like these middle of the road scores because it was so polarizing, where people were like, you can't walk straight. You're an octopus. Jesus Christ. What do you want?
I think the best videos and the best playthroughs of that is when you play co-op and you like each control separate.
Oh yeah. Any number of limbs.
Yeah, and it tests your friendship. And it tests
your relationship. Yeah, that was tricky. I tried that. It didn't go well.
Just like arms and just everywhere. Tentacles everywhere. Yeah, and your family getting slapped in the face more than once.
Yeah.
Am I on to the next question?
Yes.
So we have cat questions next, because...
Yay!
Ash and I are huge cat lovers.
Yes.
And I'm lucky enough to have a cat. And my cat, he's a bit of a... He's a character, as I've said. But he tends to be, I guess... He's massive, so he tends to like to fight anything with four legs and a tail. Dogs, cats, bunny rabbits, everything. Yeah, because we live in the country, so there's like a lot of stuff for him to chase. But he's a bit of a coward because he hates things like bubbles and snow. And like, he hates, like, when you're washing up and there's soap bubbles, he freaks out. And he's massive, so he knocks everything down. And so I love it. I think that's my favorite trait of him. But my question is there anything that your cats do that you think is like your favorite trait of theirs, basically.
This whole interview, I've been whipping a wand around to keep my fat 18-pound gray cat hoggle at bay. This whole time, my wrist is tired. I haven't stopped. I have not stopped. He's on his back right now, lazily bapping this thing around. Like, this is a nice job, right? If we could just be a cat and poop in a box and someone else feeds us. That sounds ideal.
That's like the best life in the world.
Cats, I mean, I'm a big cat advocate just because they're not as codependent and emotionally needy as dogs. But cats, like everybody I know, cats are really in tune to their owners, and they make really good nurses. Like when you're ill or depressed or sad or whatever, they will naturally get more clingy and be on top. And it's like, oh, I love you, cat. And then you're well, and they go back to ignoring you.
Well, apparently they're purring. It's at a frequency that apparently promotes like health and like muscle.
Yeah, it heals bones. What?
Yeah. And so like when they sit on you when you're sick, it's like they're trying to heal you. They're like it's little purring health machines. They just sit on you. It's just adorable. They're
weird little clerics that poop in a box.
I believe they call that cat's magic.
Cat magic.
Unfortunately, I don't have the joy of owning my own cat because I'm not allowed one in where I live at the moment, which is very depressing. And I've had dogs all my life.
But there's plenty of cats in the world to enjoy, though.
Once I buy my own place, I said to you really the other day, first thing I'm doing is getting like my own little cat, and I'm just gonna have him with me because I love cats. So I've never had one.
So, are there any space games that actually have like an onboard cat, like Jonesy from Alien? Because that seems to be missing.
that was one of the questions we had when we were on our channel, and people were like, "Do you think you'll be able to have like a pet on board like the Tempest?" And I was like, I would love a space cat. Because a space cat.
I think you should have a Jonesy.
Yeah, you should have like a.
They have fish.
They have fish the and they had hamster. But you never know.
I think cat is the next
logical
upgrade.
Step. They are made for space, though, aren't they? Because they kind of keep themselves and they don't need to be looked after that much. And I think they would love being on a ship.
Also, when the gravity gets shut off, that would be fun.
Oh yeah,
I've seen videos of cats doing the vomit comet thing, and possibly one of the funniest things I've ever seen is just them flailing wildly
because they're
to try
just
and grab
trying
onto
level
something.
Out so hard. They're like, "Why isn't this working?"
Yeah. I'm supposed to land on my feet. Why? Oh dear. But my last question is basically was about Razor and Hoggle because every day since you've been announced, you've done daily Hoggle.
Yeah.
And sometimes it hasn't always been Hoggle. They've been guest appearances from dogs and Razor and other animals too. But I just love seeing it because I said this to Rima yesterday, I think, that every time I see Hoggle especially, there's one particular photo that sticks in my mind. And it's a picture with you and Hoggle, but Hoggle looks like the camera has literally just appeared in front of him and it's scared the absolute crap out of him. It's just like, and that picture, every time I see it, just makes me laugh to no end because
I think he's got resting startled face. It's just his face. Like my friend Matt Colville, who's on Twitter, which by the way, if you need D&D pro tips on how to be a DM, go watch Matt Colville's videos. He's a writer for Turtle Rock, and he was the main writer for Evolve, and he always makes, every time I post a Hoggle photo, he makes fun of me because he's like, "Oh, who is it? Oh, it's you again." That's just his face. Like, he doesn't have another face. I'm not startling. He's doing it right now. And the only thing he's communicating is, "Human, why have you stopped waving my toy?" It's just his face. It's just his big dumb face.
I did see the other pictures of saying that Hoggle had discovered the new toys, and it always seems to be ones with like, the rods and the string on the end kind of thing, and they always seem to go for those ones.
I'm trying to make this one last because this cat's only like 2.5 years old, and he's been through like 3 or 4 different rods where he yanks the rod thing off. He just rips it off like the Hulk. And so I'm trying to make this one last by not pulling back when he gets it, because he's a monster. He's a really good cat, though. I mean, I think I'll always have a gray cat because of this cat, because I wasn't familiar with gray cat temperaments. Apparently they're all the same, but they're just sort of like, if you see, anytime you see pictures on the internet of a cat that's like belly up where their spine looks broken, or like they don't have one, they're twisting, they're just like mouth open hanging goober. And he's also like part dog, like he plays fetch poorly. But basically maybe every one out of 4 throws he'll come back with nothing and be really happy about it. And he's like, "Look, I came back, I have nothing." Great job.
I think that's half the pictures that Rima sends me that her mum sends her of the cat, which is the cat in impossible positions that animals should not be in.
She sent me pictures today of like him ninjaing because she'll leave him and then she'll turn around and he's there because we got him like, how, I was trying to think now how long ago it was. I think about like 8 years. He's fairly old now. But when we first got him, we thought he was mute because he was a stray, so we adopted him. He had no voice until one day. Aww. I think someone accidentally stood on him because he was so silent, and the voice came out then, but he doesn't meow, so he's just a bit of a ninja, but he's very stoic. He's not, I don't think he's a hyperactive cat. He's very stares and does stupid
things. It's an evil stare.
It's a very evil stare.
Well, he's part Highland wildcat, right?
Yeah,
so he's actually savage.
Yes, yeah. He's
waiting to eat.
He's always plotting, isn't he? He's always plotting.
That's it. He's got the plotting.
There's always something.
Yeah.
He's a blonde cat.
Highlander.
Something going on in those eyes. Really is. But Rima, have you got any more questions?
My last question is, it's kind of a personal question from us. Have you been to the UK? And if you have,
Oh, God, I'm so tired of the UK. I love the UK. I'm really tired of the UK. So what happened was I accidentally met my second husband last year. Mm-hmm. I went to London in June, and then I got home and I was like, oh no, this is bad. and he's an Edinburgh guy.
Not far from Rima.
I think I've been between summer of 2015 and now I've been to the UK 5 times.
Oh.
And to Scotland like 3 of those times.
Yay!
And I like, it's funny because I used to London, going to London was very exciting, and now London's this annoying piss stop between changing airport, so changing true. Planes to
yeah,
get
when you're true.
Yeah,
because there's no direct flight.
Yeah,
so now it's like, ugh, get out of my way, Heathrow, you're so annoying. I don't want to get on the bus to change terminal. And then mostly missing the flight. Yeah. So no, I love the UK, but I've only, you know, I'd never been to Scotland before. It had been on my to-do list, and now it's just on my to forever second marriage list. And all his family is in Edinburgh as well. And he just moved here, in the last month, on the fiance visa. So we're about to wrap that up. He's also, he's a sound designer for games. He was most recently at Rockstar. So, So small community is small.
So we're going to move into the fan questions now, and I think most of them are safe, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, well, we'll find out.
Yeah,
I think we did the best out, didn't we?
Yes,
kind of went through them.
Yes.
So am I starting?
Yes.
Yeah. So this is from Russell Grant, and he asks whether you have more fun playing a heroine or a villainess. If you've ever
I've been cast for villains a lot, which is super fun for me, which I don't mind at all. Like the thing I've realized in my thus far short career in VO is that typecasting is not, it's really not about what other people have necessarily seen you do. It's about the thing that you present that resonates with other people. And every time they think it's their original idea of like, you know, what do you be really good as? Even though it's like your 5th time that year and you're not going to tell them because of NDA. So you're just like, wow, yeah, I've never been a cowboy before, except for the 7 other times. And then, you know, all your things come out at once. And people are like, oh, my God, I'm so sick of seeing you as a cowboy. And you're like, it's not up to me. It's just what people want to give me money for. You don't, when you're creative, and especially in a commercial space where you are a commercial artist, like actors are, a fine artist makes their own original content. A commercial artist is bringing someone else's vision to fruition. So when you're serving someone else's vision, other people decide what you're good at, not you. Mm-hmm. What you do in your personal time, that's what you're like, this is what I like to do. And other people are like, well, this is what I'm willing to pay you for. So I've gotten to do quite a few villains, and it's so much more fun because villains tend to be, villains are never the straight man. So like the dynamics in most writing is someone's got to be a heightened character or kind of crazy or just different or unique. And then someone's got to be the straight man to react to that character. And heroes tend to be the straight man. They're just like, I'm straight laced and good and, you know, good and evil and a blocky jawline. And it's all very like, and good one again. Really boring. But villains have to constantly. So first of all, villains don't know that they're evil. They're not like, I'm doing this because I'm bad. They have their own agenda of why they think that they're right and why they think that they're doing the right thing. And then villains have to be creative every time about like, well, this last plan didn't work to foil you and destroy the world, so let's try this. So, you know, bless the villains because they never give up and they keep trying. Villains are the real fighters. Good always wins because good is lazy. But villains have to be ingenious all the time and come up with new things. So I think villains are a lot more fun, for sure.
So I'm glad I get this next one because I actually cannot pronounce the name. So I'm going to try my best here. Sakura.
You're close, yeah.
Awesome. asks, what are your hobbies? And also she thinks that your picture, your old Twitter profile picture before your current one, is badass.
So I had my headshots done a couple years ago by Chad Michael Ward, who... Chad Michael Ward, if you look him up, he did what he called, what he's told me is his $10,000 business card, like probably 10 years ago. He did this amazing photo series. I think it's called The Pain Box, which you can look up. And it's all like this really just gorgeous and intense horror-centric photo collection where like someone's blindfolded and has got tentacles bursting out underneath them, or like someone tied up in a wheelchair and looking all very Silent Hill, and just like, I really love that photo series. You know, also he photographs like nudie pics and cheese girls and cheesecake. He does rock band rock videos, music videos, and rock band photos and stuff like that. And he's pretty well known in LA, so I always followed his career online. So when I started VO, like all my, I'm never gonna go to anybody else for headshots because his perspective is so, it's just so cool and creative. And because I don't do on camera, I strictly do VO, it doesn't really matter what I look like. Mm-hmm. So I have the freedom to do whatever the hell I want for headshots, because I'm never gonna have to show up to like the typical LA cattle call where they're like, we need a blonde model, and you show up and there's like 13 other people who look exactly like you because it's a meat market. And your headshots are meant to be, headshots are traditionally meant to be your most like plainest, rawest, least interesting version of yourself, so that casting directors can project their needs onto you like a blank canvas. And I kind of refuse to be a blank canvas because that's freaking boring and not part of my job. So I'm probably due for another round of headshots. So yeah, if you want to check out Chad Michael Ward's work online, it's well worth it. It's always really interesting visually.
We'll link it in our, we'll find it and we'll link in our description for the video so they can.
He's just cool. Yeah, I think it's just ChadMichaelAward.com. I mean, he's directed a horror film and all this stuff, but I mean, there's so many interesting creative people in LA to work with that I just can't imagine doing anything straight-laced or like quote unquote the right way, because that's so boring. Like I was telling Kodak yesterday, like one of my acting idols is legitimately Danny Trejo, because he gets hired to be Danny Trejo, mm-hmm. and to be like the loudest, direct, most purest version of Danny Trejo he can be. And that's great, because when somebody writes in their spec or treatment, I want someone like Danny Trejo, hey, there's no one like Danny Trejo. You're gonna have to hire him or change the character, because you know, because he is so defiantly proud and comfortable in his own skin. And I think that's an extremely admirable goal, because especially in acting, a lot of people are comfortable in being any skin but theirs, which is why they're an actor, because they just want to disappear in a role, and then as themselves they're like, yeah, I don't know, which means people also don't know what to do with you, right? Because you don't know who you are. So
mm-hmm. yeah.
There was another part to that question, but I just went off the rails.
Oh yeah, what were your hobbies?
Well, this whole time I've been keeping my cat entertained for an hour. I mean, I don't get paid for this. I should.
That's determination on your part and on his part.
He hasn't stopped. He hasn't gotten tired. To be fair, half of it's been on his back, like a baby babbing a mobile, so I'm kind of not working very hard. Well, coming from games industry, obviously I'm a gamer, so I play games when I'm willing to make time for it. And lifting's a heavy thing, so I haven't been to the gym in a while, but I need to get back on that. As far as hobbies, Jesus. I'm really bad. The main thing that you get told about when you're an actor is like, you need to have a life, but I'm kind of business obsessed and I like working too much to like there are other actors out there. Like Jennifer Hale's a great example. She's always like, I'm horseback riding, mountain climbing, rescuing horses, rescuing mountains, hugging mountains, going to Nepal. Like she's living her life. And I'm like, I'm on my computer on Twitter and I'm fine with it. And I'm ordering Indian takeaway because I refuse to cook. The end. I think I'm a pretty average nerd outside of work.
Sounds fairly similar to a couple of people that I know. Us.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. Rima, do you want to go on to the next one? I'm looking forward to this one.
So this one's from Exotic Valkyrie. A lot of probably Mass Effect voice actors probably get asked this, and you'll probably get asked this when you do more interviews and things like that, because it just tends to be a thing. I know Mark, Mia, and Jennifer Hill always get asked, but somebody wanted to ask, and you're definitely allowed to say no, because you don't have to. So I wanted to know whether you can say, I'm Sara Ryder, and this is my favourite channel on the extranet. Presumably in the Sara Ryder voice, and you're going to ask us again, but again, you can say no, but we ask.
To be, well, in the quest for space democracy, I'm going to be asked to do that for everybody, aren't I? There, you are all my favorite podcasts, incidentally. Yep. All of them, all of my children are the same. So yeah, Kodak asked yesterday if I could say what the voice is, and like, I mean, I can't, I don't know. It's like saying, what does a frog sound like? just the way I'd put it, like, I do the actory thing where, let's back it up. So a lot of people think VO is, it's doing funny voices. And anytime that comes up in a panel, voice actors shut it down immediately. And they're like, no, it's about acting. You have to be an actor first. Voices mm-hmm. are secondary. And that's absolutely true because you have to convey whatever the range of, you know, emotions and reality is for that character, regardless of what they sound like. And if you can't do that first, then you can't do the job. So with like, I do Sara Ryder the same way I do most things, unless there's like an age limit or something where you have to sound like you're 8 years, like, you know, I don't sound like I'm 8 years old right now, probably not passable. So if there isn't a modifier like that, it's like, okay, so what would I sound like if I'd been raised by, you know, Alec Ryder as the character, and this was my upbringing, and then this happened to me, and then this happened to me. Like, how would these things affect me? And then it sort of like gets dialed in like a padlock. Of how does that affect the way I feel about things and I process things, so that it all comes out organically out my mouth the way it should, in a for me anyway, like a consistently real, believable way where I buy it. And if it's real for me, it's real for you. If it's not real for me and I'm pretending, then it's garbage. That is just like hammy pretend acting where it's like, oh, I'm so sad, I'm so happy. That's not real. That's, I mean, unless you're asked to do that kind of hammy over the top soap opera stuff, that's just bad.
I think that reminds me of something as well, and I think it was for Bioshock Infinite, and I know Troy Baker was the voice of Booker DeWitt. I for the life of me now, I can't remember who was the voice of Elizabeth in that game, but
Courtney Draper.
Thank you very much. I know I was going to feel really bad if I didn't find out at some point. But there's like little bits after you complete the game and you see them doing the voice work. As the credits roll, and that I found that really interesting. So I went online and I looked for kind of a bit more of that. And there's this one thing that I saw which wasn't quite disturbing, but it was kind of shocking. And
oh, no.
She was getting it's not that bad, trust me.
The thing where he makes her cry?
Yes. Yeah.
Isn't that rad?
It's just like, I'm just like, she's like, okay, just swear at me, just, you know, verbally abuse me, just go for it and make me upset. And he just hurls abuse at her, and obviously she's asked him to do this, and I'm just like, this is how much voice actors get into the roles. And yes, they can do a lot of roles over their careers, but this is how a character is made. So, and that always kind of like shocked and surprised me, and kind of in a good way, because it kind of opens your eyes.
Well, that's like when I was watching like all the stuff after Arkham City came out, and watching Mark Hamill in the booth playing the Joker, he turns into the Joker. It's really creepy, and like, from when you grew up watching like Mark Hamill in Star Wars to seeing him play the Joker is just like the most unbelievable, unsettling, but most awesome thing ever as well. Like he actually contorts himself and turns into it. So it's just a remarkable, like, and just because you can't see the person's face, it's just still remarkable what you can do in the booth.
Well, it has to be really actually happening to you in the moment, whatever it is. If it's not, even if you're not aware that it's being faked, you'll be like, this is bad and I don't like it. I don't know why, but I don't like it. Well, that's why. Like, every time you buy a movie ticket or you go to an art gallery or you buy music, you're doing it because you're exchanging money for the experience of feeling something. You know, I mean, you might not be aware of this, but you're handing your money over and saying, please make me feel something, anything. And if you don't feel something, anything, you don't feel like you got your money's worth. That's art for profit. So backing it up to just, you know, how the sausage is made, if I'm not feeling anything and everything when I'm making it, well, neither are you. That's just, I mean, that's just A to B right there. So, regarding like doing, doing call outs as Sara Ryder, I think it's better if we wait till after ship.
Yes.
Fair enough. Yeah.
Because right now I'm still Fryda Wolff. And per EA, I'm just Fryda Wolff. I know nothing. I see nothing. I do nothing. I love to not get sued.
I think we all like to not.
Yeah, we're hoping that we'll get to see both you and get to hear your voice more in the kind of like promotional stuff come out, because we got to hear Tom's voice in the PS4 Pro. So,
yeah,
your turn.
No, it'll happen more. I just think it's easy in the same way where it's like, I mean, Troy's a great example. Like, Troy definitely starts with himself as a baseline. Like, you can hear it. That's how you know, oh, it's Troy Baker. And then from there, he just like stretches out to like, okay, well, what does it sound like if these things are happening to me and this is my background? Or like, with like Bioshock Infinite is the first game that I ever played where I actually gave a crap about story. Like, before, I was like, I'm a very bad gamer. I don't like RPGs because there's too much dialogue. Yes, I know how ironic it is. But like, I just want to like click through and skip all the dialogue, and I walk out of the room if there's an unskippable cutscene, because I just want to loot and murder and loot and murder and loot and murder and level up so I can loot and murder better. And then Bioshock Infinite was the first game that just like made me really stop and feel things. It was such a punch to the gut. Mm-hmm. And that's when I mean, it's pretty recent, but that's when I really started paying attention to voice actors and voice actors' performances. And so like Troy and everything he does, it's definitely Troy, but it's a completely engrossed character for him, because he's in it very deeply. And it's like, okay, well, these things have happened to me and these things are happening to me, and this is what it sounds like. So if you stack up like his performances, like what you put like Infinite next to Far Cry next to Last of Us, those are just disparately different characters. Like, you could not interchange the lines, right? But you still know it's Troy. Okay. I think that's good voice acting. Voice acting is not hiding behind the mask of, it's not necessarily your range. Like, I mean, it's still a compliment when someone's like, I had no idea that was you. Thank you. I'm glad you weren't like, that just sounds like Fryda being Fryda. But when I'm asked to do like an organic, grounded character that is not cartoony, like, you know, like a Sara Ryder, where it's like, okay, that's what makes Mass Effect and frankly all BioWare games at large work, right? Is that it doesn't matter if your character is a freaking demon-headed, tail-whipping, elf-eared space thing. It doesn't matter, because the character is real and grounded and having very, very human feelings, right?
Yeah.
Versus being like, I'm a demon, blah, blah. You'd be like, get out, your nonsense.
But I'm glad that you kind of picked Bioshock Infinite for that example there, because for story, and I love my story games, but Bioshock Infinite is very near and dear to my heart, because as soon as I played it, I've only played that game like five. I say only five times.
I've only played the game five times.
Yeah, but that's because of the story and because of the way it's played and portrayed to me, and I love it, and I get engrossed in it every single time. And I recently just bought the Bioshock Infinite collection, and I'm currently reworking through Bioshock 1, which is also one of my all-time favorite games. But when Infinite came along, it was just a kick to the head, and I've always said that, and I loved every bit of voice acting in it, and I loved the story, and I had to play the game again just to understand that I got the understanding of the ending on the original playthrough correct, because it's just one big wallop at the end of the game. It's just like, oh, and I'm not going to spoil it for people who haven't played it yet, Rima.
Like me.
But
to get on that,
I know that he's convincing me.
I've been poking her to get it. It's in the sale.
I have many games to play.
but that game is a great example. Bioshock Infinite. It's such a, if people want story during game, that's a hell of a story, and it plays so well as well, and it just gives you an all round fantastic gaming experience. And I know a lot of people are like, oh, I play PC, I play console, but as long as you enjoy the game, it doesn't matter. So, and yeah, I absolutely love that game, and I always will, because it's probably, bar Mass Effect and possibly Halo, it's probably my most favorite game of all time, and I'll continue to play that probably until the day I die. So, and there's no DLC for that either, so it's just that one story, And then...
I could make fun of you for the love letter to BioShock, but like the second I finished Infinite, I lost my mind a bit, and I tracked down a bunch of people who worked on it and wrote them extensive love letters, and now they're all my friends because that's how I do.
Oh, dang it.
And now I've gotten to like work with them and VO, which is very funny. Like, you know, because after, you know, Infinite crashed the company and Irrational went under, like a lot of those people ended up either doing their own projects or working with other companies, and they've since like given me opportunities to work with them, which is really cool. And that all just came from me writing to them and saying, I love you. I love what you did. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you so much.
Hug me.
Yeah. Yeah. Hold me. I love you.
Never let me go. So I'll move on to the next one. Now, this one was kind of a free barrel question, but you've answered two of the barrels already. So I'm just going to go straight to the third barrel, which is, do you feel that Mass Effect... Oh, this is from Samuel Matthew McCarthy, by the way. And they ask, do you feel that getting the role of Sara Ryder in Mass Effect Andromeda will have like a big impact on your career going forward?
It definitely sets up the expectation that I'm very well aware of the responsibility where do I start? So people remember Jennifer Hale and Mark Meer and all that because you, as the player, insert yourself into their avatars and you live in that world through them, or, you know, whatever RPG protagonist you are. And it's their words are your words because you're so immersed in the game. You become emotionally connected to them. But the truth is the protagonist has the boring job, because the protagonist is the straight man that is there to react to everything in the world that's happening to them and around them. I think the real workload, like for me, the workload is just the sheer volume of lines, right? But the real workload, I think, bears on all the other tertiary characters, all the squad mates, all the other players in that world, because they get to stretch very far in a particular direction. They really get to dig their heels into an original character that's playing to a very particular flavor, and go full out. And then my job is to react to that. And when you think about it, like my job's the boring job. My job is like, I don't get to be interesting, because I have to be loose and flexible enough for you to enjoy it without, acquiring a very specific point of view. Does that make sense? So like,
yes. Yeah. You're basically like a black canvas for like the person playing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So like I laughed. So like I went through some threads after N7 because I'm a sweet masochist. And the one complaint I saw about my casting, of course on Reddit, but I really enjoyed it because the guy didn't know how on the nose he was. He's like, ugh, I hate this casting, and she's so boring, and she's so plain. She just sounds like a person. I'm like, yes, I've nailed it. If you go look at Octodad, Tom and I literally have credits as every man and every woman. And that's important. Like, if the world is populated with James Earl Joneses, then nobody stands out because everyone sounds like James Earl Jones. That's not interesting anymore. You need to have people who are proficient at being normal, everyday, relatable laymen, so that people who have either very unique sounds or very unique points of view or very unique characters can stand out. And that's how you make dynamics, in the same way that like music can't be all loud or all quiet without you tuning out, without your brain just tunes out from the boredom. So in the same way, you have to have these punctuations in a story or in an ensemble cast. You have to have some notes that are stronger or more flavorful or louder than others. So my job to serve you as the player is to just absorb and react to everything in a believable, relatable way and not be too crazy. I mean, unless it's something that's heightened where it's like, I'm drunk or I'm high and I'm going to be real wacky. Okay. Then you roll with that. But if I'm just being a person, I just have to be a person who's existing in that space. I have showed up every day just I cannot bear the weight of like, oh my god, it's Mass Effect, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, because I would just crumble and not get any work. Again, it's just like when you're working with somebody famous, you're like, oh my god, oh my god, no. You have to be able to compartmentalize, freak out about later, but when you're there, the time is taking and get the work done. So the same thing every day with Mass Effect. I can't be like, oh my god, it's Mass Effect, oh my god. I have to show up and be like, all right, let's do work. And I mean, I'll say this till I'm blue in the face, because BioWare has been doing this so long with these line intensive games. They have the process down to a science. I think the way they run sessions is exemplary for the industry. To be fair, not every game has as many lines as a BioWare game. I mean, sometimes all you can do is show up for a 1-4-hour session and every other line is going to be reloading, grenade. Oh, fine. Those games aren't going anywhere. And they're also not going to have, you know, intensive storylines like grenade. Also, I've really been wanting to talk to you about a relationship. Can we just like, step aside behind this trench so we can talk about, because I've been having feelings like that's not going to happen. But for the way BioWare runs things, just two things. One, I'm forever grateful for the experience to the directors and everybody who just kind of like coddles and massages me and Tom through every day. And like, you can imagine how work intensive it is. It's a lot, like the emotional gear shifting. Like, so I posted on YouTube not long ago, a video where I'm just like losing my mind in the booth.
I saw that one. Yeah,
that's an Andromeda session. That's my director at the end talking me down from the ledge, because the emotional gear shifting is so hard from like, now you're sad, now you're happy, now you're murdering, now you're back to sad, now you're having sex in combat, just whatever. And like, I have to go there, right? Like, I have to go full on to all those extremes. It makes you kind of loopy.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just like an emotional mess by the end of every session. I'm just kind of like in a puddle. And I
Do they bring the warm blanket, you know?
Yeah, they kind of scoop me off the floor. Yeah. They just kind of like let me sit in a corner and rock back and forth and recuperate. So sometimes by the end, it's like, it's just like the wiring in my brain is so broken that it's just like uncontrollable giggle fits and stuff. And like, I'll snap together and get through it and I make my line counts and stuff, but it is hard work. So just, I have like, I think like combat veteran, relatable, mutual respect. It's like, you know, veteran, like if you've been in a war and you meet someone else who has combat experience, there's just like this immediate brotherly understanding. Anybody who's ever worked in a BioWare game, I salute you. you to the end of time.
Fair enough. The next question is from Ask Alice, and she asks, what was it like working on the park and Evolve stage 2?
So the park is bananas, because that's another like gigantic hard shift emotional roller coaster, and we did that in one session. and also like I didn't know what I was working on. Like I got I mentioned this on Codec yesterday, but I will say this again until I'm blue in the face. The park was originally just a 3-month project for Funcom to internally R&D whether or not they wanted to use Unreal in the future going forward. It was just for testing purposes, and Funcom brass also added, by the way, if we like this, we'll fund it to ship. So that game was made in 7 months total, with one designer, one artist, one programmer, and one audio person, and maybe like a couple other towards the end, added on staff, like maybe a couple other coders, maybe another artist. But that was it. And they shipped that whole thing in 7 months. And I got asked to do my part during the R&D phase, because so Joel Bylos, who's the creative director over at Funcom, he's also in charge of Secret World and all that. This was his pet project. And so once he got this carrot to chase after of like, this might ship, he was like, oh, it's on. And this is all his creative impetus. The writing is all his. His wife is a psychologist who I believe works in social services, so with like families and things. And he has two young daughters. And also incidentally, Rob King, who is the sound engineer slash booth director, also has a young daughter. And I'm not a parent, but I have friends who have been through postpartum depression, which is a very it's very difficult to explain how visceral and devastating that is, especially when you don't know you're having postpartum depression. So I go in and, you know, as usual, I don't know what I'm working on, and I get the story and it's like, God damn. All right, let's go to work. So I've felt pretty well taken care of, especially like by two dudes who, you know, who've had wives, who've had daughters, who've been through like that whole process. So I could feel, they would tell me if I was being disingenuous, with the feeling, like I just thought a lot about my mother and that whole dynamic. So it was a really, really intense morning. But I mean, ultimately, they got the green light. They finished the game. I might have done maybe one pickup session for like promotional stuff or something. But then we shipped. And I was really proud of that because it's hard to dive so deep into such a dark and serious topic with no prior heads up or research. So that was just a test. But even if some of it's cringy for me, where it's like, you know, in the future as a more mature actor, I could have been more raw and honest about it. I did the best I could. So I'm pretty proud with how that turned out. So that was good. And then for Evolve, Evolve Stage 2 is just, I mean, that's just Evolve. Like they tacked on, they've changed some of the gameplay stuff. And so we just added on more. So Evolve was the last game I worked on as a sound designer. So when they, and I had to audition and I didn't know what I was auditioning for, like they cast me on very annoyingly as Kyra, who's a healer in the, that you can have in your party. And then also as like the tutorials. So it was just sort of like an internal joke over there. I was like, oh my God, she won't go away. She just won't go away. You left. Why are you? But I mean, I love those guys. Like Turtle Rock Studios, who made Evolve. Those are the guys who made Left 4 Dead. Valve did not make Left 4 Dead. Mm-hmm. Valve bought and paid for Left 4 Dead and did all the back end stuff with getting like multiplayer servers and all that, and you know, the Steam platform and all that stuff. But the game was made by 12 people in Orange County at Turtle Rock Studios, the end. So they were like my idols, because Left 4 Dead is such a just monumental game.
Yes.
So that was a real privilege to get to work with them, both on the developer and the VO side. So I was happy I got to be a part of Evolve for sure. And again, that's Matt Colville's writing. He's just a cool dude. I encourage people to annoy him. He's a writer, so he hates it.
Next one was from Katniss Ashes, and they ask, what's your favorite and least favorite thing about working in VO?
So my favorite thing is like I show up for the party and I leave. When I was when you're a sound designer, like it's your job, especially if you're an internal sound designer, it's your job to make the assets, so you're making all the sounds that go in, but you also have to be responsible for implementing. And sometimes that means not just doing stuff through a visual tool where you're just like point and click and add and drop and then test in a game. Sometimes you actually have to do the manual labor of scripting, which I hated. Like I don't like staring at lines of text in Notepad, making sure that none of my slashes or parentheses are out of place. It's just not my jam. I think I would have thrived much better and enjoyed the job more if I had been either a contract sound designer or somebody who works in post-production where you're doing a final mix, but you're not doing anything programmatical. Cause it's definitely being willing and even better proficient at least scripting stuff in games just accelerates your career and just makes you a better sound designer all around. And I just wasn't willing to do that work. So with VO, I show up and I make assets with my mouth and then I leave, and I'm not responsible for implementing it. I'm not responsible for making sure it fires off correctly in game. I am relieved of that responsibility. I just show up, I party, I say thank you, and I leave. maybe, I don't know, the least, it's hard to complain about a job that isn't manual labor. I mean, it's really grossly difficult to justify whining about not being in a coal mine. But if I do my job and I have an especially like emotionally draining day, and then I have to come home and still do auditions, there's just like usually not a lot left in me to give. Like I have to kind of curl up and be quiet for a couple hours and recuperate. And it's difficult to admit. I mean, also like your voice is a finite resource, right? Like you can't talk all day and all night and not have consequences, especially if sometimes you're projecting and yelling. Like you rip it up and you might be done beyond your physical limits, but also just emotionally, you don't realize how draining it is. Because again, like if I have a fight in a game, well, as far as my brain and my body and my adrenal glands know, that was a real fight. And then I'm really tired afterwards. Again, it sounds like really first world whingy to complain about, but if you go through an emotional battering, you are actually emotionally battered. Mm-hmm. And you have to be able to separate that from what's really going on in your life, if you actually have any real conflicts or don't have conflicts. I think self-care, also actors are notoriously not good at self-care, and just being able to shut down, be quiet, not talk, and just kind of center emotionally and physically. But like the admitting that you can't push yourself forever is really, really hard. And that is so rich coming from me, because I will work myself to death, because I, you know, like there's a pressure to stay on top of the hamster wheel. If you run into this really stupid problem where if you're successful and you're busy during the day, it doesn't matter. Like for me, when I complete work in Andromeda, there's going to be a Mass Effect sized hole in my schedule. That's a real issue for my income. Mm-hmm. So throughout working on Mass Effect, even though it consumes a lot of, you know, my time, I still have to be able to come home and do whatever auditions and do as many auditions as I can muster, because I need to have work for the future when my current work runs out. When you're an actor, you're fired every day, especially a voice actor. Like the turnaround, like if you're in film or TV, your contract lasts like, you know, anywhere from a month to 3 months to a year, however long it takes to film your project, and then you're out of a job. We're out of a job every 1 to 4 hours. So I like to say, like, I'm fired every day or multiple times a day. So the pressure to acquire new work never goes away. And that can be pretty leveling, I think. It definitely keeps you humble, because your success right now, today, means nothing if you don't have future work waiting for you to, you know, pay your rent 6 months from now.
Yeah.
So, and that's just part of the job. You accept that going in.
So, Rima, do you want to come on with the next question?
Yeah. This is by, I'm going to wreck his name, Philip Lewis Bias? Bias? I'm going to say it's Bias.
I'll go with that.
He asked, with the history of progressive dialogue and inclusiveness, non-traditional characters are at the front of BioWare games. How excited are you to be part of a franchise that's given such powerful heroes to LGBT gamers?
That's a really, it's important. So, I mean, there's always that awesome compilation that's gone around of people just like posting like the latest, whatever the latest 16 game box covers are of like a white protagonist with a shaved head with blue eyes with some stubble, maybe showing you his butt and like the title on top. There's enough of those. There's a lot of those.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
having very, very vanilla relationships and things going on. And BioWare's like, yeah, we don't care. We don't care. You should be able to do whatever. I mean, like, no spoilers, but nobody is a bigger champion for women getting theirs than BioWare, I'm happy to say. Which is a big deal to me, because so often, like, the, you know, a lot of the writing, it's nobody's fault. Like, it's important. Every time you take a critical look, like Anita Sarkeesian's Feminist Frequency series and all that, I mean, the main thing that she puts forth, it's just human psychology. You write what you know. And every piece of writing ever is the writer's projection of their own wants, needs, their view of the world and their experience, because you're not physically capable of having anything else. That your worldview is your worldview. And the only way you're going to figure out what other people feel, think, or want is by asking, or by incorporating, or by throwing them in the writer's room. BioWare seems to have like a really healthy mix of individuals from all walks, all colors, all sexualities. Just like, I think they try to cover as many bases as possible, which most people can't be bothered with. So that's really cool. And that definitely shows up in the writing. I'm trying to think. Again, typecasting, I'm really good at being gay. That's happened more than a few times where I've either been brought in for callbacks or for actual work where they're like, and you're a lesbian. Great. Awesome. Fantastic. Hope I get this right. Like I myself, I'm openly bisexual, which I don't think is like, I don't think that's even really a usable term anywhere anymore, because it used to be like, well, men were men, women were women, and we don't talk about anybody else. And now I think we're definitely at a societal place where it's like, well, can we at least acknowledge that there are people who are intersex or transgender or comfortably transvestite in either direction, where it's like you're comfortably being a biological woman who dresses in men's clothes or vice versa. So like limiting yourself sexually has just never made sense to me personally, because people are not limited. Like, people don't come out of a 1950s style factory where boys wear blue and girls wear pink. That's just weird. So I'm extremely lucky, obviously, to work with a company that also believes that shouldn't go on in their games. I don't know. I just, every base is covered. Every base. Yeah. All the bases are covered. Awesome. in every color.
Yeah. I think that's kind of something that a lot of people have said to us over the time we've done the channel, and they've always been kind of happy with. the way BioWare is kind of been inclusive of basically everything and everyone. And obviously when it comes to space games, you have a lot more races to cover and things like that as well. Like, you've got you going into Andromeda alone, you've got the Asari, you've got the Turians, you've got... you may help me out here, I've forgotten one.
Krogans.
Thank you.
I've been pretty open about, like, sorry, I've played 79 minutes of Mass Effect because I can't RPGs, and also the combat, oh god. I'll try to pick up Mass Effect 2, I really will. So I've had learn trial by fire on the job about, like, how all the races work and stuff. And just, I've gotten to know, obviously, like, every race's personality and cultural norms regarding, like, mating and mating rituals and courtship and like how they approach relationships and stuff. It's pretty freaking diverse, which is nice because it's not like you have all these weird looking humanoids. If they all treated dating exactly the same way, that would be just like a waste of everyone's time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah. So I just like how, like, their cultural norms bleeds out into how they interact with the protagonist and everyone else. It's like, well, you know, we're Klingon, so this is how we do things with our people, deal with it. Cool. Yeah. Thanks for being different. The Klingons are not in Mass Effect Andromeda.
No.
That is not a spoiler.
I was wondering if that was an exclusive, Klingons.
That's the exclusive downloadable content.
Yes, the Klingons are coming.
Specifically.
Moving on to the next one. This kind of goes into kind of what you do for hobbies and stuff, but it becomes a bit more specific. It's any shows or video games you binge, watch, or play. If so, which ones are they?
There's too much TV. There's so much TV right now. I have a subscription to Hulu and Amazon and Netflix, and I don't know why, because I can't do all of it. I really try, but I can't.
I thought I was like drying up on Netflix recently, and then Rima's mom allowed me to use her Amazon Video, and that whole thing just started all over again. I'm watching every single series now. I'm just like, crap, what have I done?
I can't. I don't know how. I mean, how do they even decide things like award shows, like Emmys and BAFTAs? Like, who? No one's watching all the TV shows. It's all a lie. People are just voting for the shows they've actually watched.
Yeah,
pretty much.
I'm convinced. I'm a big pop culture idiot, and I'm pretty obsessive with shows and television and stuff, and there's just so much right now. So it was really funny, I got into Outlander on Stars, which is all about time traveling Highlander Scottish Jacobite era romance.
Yes.
while for the whole year and a half I've been working on my fiance visa with a Lowlander, non-Jacobite, non-swarthy, non-Highlander, not in a kilt guy. But it's still just really funny because Outlander is just like basically this giant come to Scotland travel brochure.
Yeah, pretty much.
Like, they offer freaking Outlander tours now, which, like, incidentally, if you watch Outlander, there's a scene at a mill, like a very specific scene at a mill by river, and that's actually Preston Mill, and that's by that's in East Lothian, where my dude actually grew up, out in East Lothian. So, like, I've been to that mill. It's like a, I don't know, a 14th 15th century, or like the last working mill from that era in Scotland, and it was just like bizarre to watch and be like, I've been there, oh god I'm that person. It's like I've done a Sex in the City tour without meaning to. But yeah, Outlander's a kick in the pants, which, by the way, every woman I know who makes their man watch it, it's like, watch that and take notes. Another woman's a lot happier. I'm just saying, if you're in a relationship with a woman of any kind, you should just watch that show and take notes. Just my gift to you. So Outlander's pretty good. Oh god, there's just too much TV. Like, I can't even... Hulu's been devastating for that, because Hulu keeps up with current television shows, and we're in the era of nostalgia wank right now pretty hard.
Yes, yeah.
Like, if you're in the late 20s to early 40s, everything that was old is new again. And if you get the Goldbergs, it's a pretty hard nostalgia wank, but it's so good. Jesus Christ. So the Goldbergs is crazy endearing. The showrunner creator.
Is that, yeah, Adam Goldberg? And he did that show about his childhood. Yeah.
Yeah. So that show's amazing because the showrunner actually, like, was one of those privileged upper middle class families who actually had a video camera in the early 80s and recorded everything. And every single episode is like based off of a tape that he recorded of his family, either at an event or just like him harassing his father and his father saying, get that thing out of my face. And they build a whole episode. And then at the end of every episode, they actually do a side by side where the actors recreate the video to the letter and they do a split screen. It's like, nostalgia wanks that are just disingenuous, where it's like, well, we're recreating the 80s or 90s of our fantasies and not the 80s and 90s of our reality. Goldberg manages to do like this heightened sitcom that still follows the primer of these videos. It's really super endearing. That's, I think, a really good one right now, too. And also, like, some levity. I mean, if you want to be, which, I mean, I'm being a total hypocrite, but if you want to immerse yourself in the reality of how terrible things are in the world geopolitically, you can, of course, watch The Americans and Mr. Robot and The Man in High Castle. Why not? Throw yourself headlong into dystopia, set yourself on fire, you know, have double passwords on everything, have fun. But also, it's just nice to have some candy once in a while.
Yeah.
So I think Goldberg is pretty good for that.
I must admit, actually, you just mentioned Mr. Robot. I just started season two of Mr. Robot. So, yeah.
God bless you.
Yeah. It just makes me anxious, Mr. Robot.
Yeah.
It really does. But, like,
it makes me really anxious.
Well, we used to get excited about dystopia because, you know, it's exciting to think about, what if the world was just really dangerous and everyone's just listening to everything you say, and now it's real?
Yeah.
So now it's like a little less, oh, this is fun. This is a good show. Good show now.
It's a bit too real. It's getting a bit too real.
Yeah, watch at your own peril, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Black Mirror or whatever.
Oh, I just watched that one recently as well. Ugh. It was the last one that gets me, though. It's the robot wasps. That's all I'm going to say, because that's one of the new series. But that's like an hour and a half feature length episode, and that's a kick in the pants. I'll say that much. But yeah, Black Mirror as a whole is just kind of weird. And there's that one with the social media scores as well, and like everyone's trying to up their social media scores to get to a certain level of social acceptance and all stuff like that, and it's just like, how close are we to this exactly?
We already have it in China. Like, there's the government has a grading system for every person, and it's based on like their income, social status, their social media, blah blah blah. Like, that's already done. That's already a thing.
Oh my god. I'm
yeah,
watching Black Mirror again.
It's going to that, like, it's going to turn that episode of Community when they have that weird social media app thing that they're all using, and it like ranks their like society in like the community college. It's going to turn into that. That's what it's going to turn into. God. It's just be weird. It's getting too close to the fact that all those kind of things are happening.
The thing I think that every time someone's like, I wonder if I'm on a list already on Twitter, I'm like, I think we're all on a list at this point. Like, you can't not be on a list. If you've ever been on Twitter, you're on some kind of list.
Just creeped out.
It's too real.
I'm here to help you escape from your fantasy to reality to fantasy and back in where you don't know what's happened.
And this is going into the last question. This is from Carl Mjolnir. And they ask, how did it feel being one of the main voice actors in a well-loved and well-established series like Mass Effect?
I just hope I don't annoy anybody. I mean, like, they cut it to the point, like, all the people have been like, who are like, they don't mean to be creepy, they're like, I can't wait to spend hundreds of hours with you. And it's like, I hope you don't get sick of me, because you're stuck with me. It's pretty humbling. I mean, like I said earlier, like, I completely understand the emotional attachment to the protagonist voices and voice actors, because they become you. Like, I am here for you to insert yourself into me and have a good time, just like it sounds. like, right, like, you get to take over essentially my body avatar with my mouth sounds and have a go. Enjoy. I mean, it's a pretty intimate experience, right? So
well, when you put it that way,
yeah, it sounds like it's gonna be
right. Oh yeah, no, it's in 4D now. We're testing it out with new VR gear. My hope is that my effort and my hard work shows up, and it shouldn't feel like hard work for the gamer. It should just feel real and natural, and that's the hard work for the actor, of like, okay, it's just always being present and engaged and making it natural. So I hope that comes through for players. I hope it just doesn't feel like work, and I hope it just feels like an adventure that you're living.
I'm sure it will,
and I'm sure that you guys have got great material to work with, because BioWare do such a great job with their stories and their dialogue. So that probably helps.
I have to like break it down for myself and make jokes, and it's so it just if I had to summarize Mass Effect or probably any BioWare game, it just comes down to two questions. Can I sex you? No? Can I sex you now? Okay, bye. So that's like every conversation loop. And then the other one is like, so tell me more about this thing that you're doing here that I have no business involving myself in. But like, you know, you're obviously busy doing whatever your personal life, religious practice, family matter, whatever. Tell me more about that. Excuse me, who are you? No, it's cool. It's cool. I'm the protagonist of this game. So you have to tell me what you're doing right now. Like, tell me. So is this your girlfriend? Cool. And like, you basically become like a really intrusive stand-up comedian where you're like, so is this your girlfriend? Are you guys from out of town? Cool. Cool. How long have you been together? Cool. Cool. Can I sex you? No? Okay, bye. And then you get in your spaceship and you fly away and you go to the next one. And that's just like, the challenge is just, first of all, taking that seriously and not breaking down as a human being, because I have to do that so many times and be sincere about it. But also just like my... me, Fryda, is just like, none of your goddamn business. These people are none of your business. What's going on in this bar? Go home. Go home. Take off your pants and go to sleep. Like, what? It is not your job to fix everything, writer. God. But that's what they pay me for.
It's like,
so, yeah. So please enjoy the tens of thousands of times I had to say, so what's going on here? No, I'm really interested. And I'm like, no, I mean, keep doing what you're doing, but just tell me more about it. To complete strangers you've never met before.
It's like, I'm the protagonist. You must tell me everything, because I need to know.
It's like, no, you see, I'm the protagonist for this world, so you have to tell me about how you're making this bread. No, I mean, I know you're busy, but it's your job to tell me these things. So just go ahead. I'm listening. I'm listening. I'm listening. Can I? Okay, can we have sex now? No, okay, I'm done with you. Okay, bye.
You didn't tell me about the bread, so I'm not having sex with you.
Yeah, and that's Mass Effect Andromeda.
And fair enough.
And now so, I get to. So
bread sex? That's basically what
bread sex.
Yeah.
Bread sex. Yep. I don't know why. I think I've used bread before. When did I use bread? What's his face? Like, BioFan was bugging me about something. Oh, yeah, because I've already said on Twitter, like, as E has said, you can say you're a character in the game and that's about it. Great. So it's gotten to the point where, like, I've said on Twitter, if you 20 questions me, I'll either ignore you or mute you and never hear from you again, because I have to. I can't be arsed to keep up with questions I can't answer.
Yeah, fair enough.
And BioFan got a little uppity and was asking a bunch of stuff. And I was just like, you know what? I'm like two tweets away from saying Sara Ryder is bread. And he was just like, bread cannon confirmed. So now I'm just happy to confirm whatever canon. I mean, like, I think the best part of Mass Effect fans is that y'all are so obsessive that you're willing to make conspiracy theories out of nothing.
Yes.
Which is really, I mean, I can't imagine how developers feel, because I'm not even involved in, you know, whatever is or isn't canon. And it's a riot for me just watching everybody kind of like speculate and spin and be like, what about this? What about this? What about this? When half the podcasts are like, I don't know. What if? And it just becomes like basically debating wish lists, which is really amusing for me. So I think, like, the latest canon I confirmed yesterday, I've decided that I was the first twin born, just because
we saw that.
Yeah, well, because I just want to be able to lord that over Tom and be like, well, you have to listen to me because I'm older.
Well,
and I was like, I don't care what we're talking about. No, you can have bacon on your sandwich because I'm older.
I'm just gonna bully him.
Yeah. Any advantage? I'm 5'4". Any advantage I can get, I will take.
But I do agree with the person who commented back and saying that Baby Bro Riders has just a nice ring to it. It does. It does. Baby Bro Rider does have a little.
He is a cute one, though, isn't he? My God, that avatar is so hot. Like, sorry to like Luke and Leia it, but yeah, God damn.
You should have heard Rima when we first saw that trailer. She was like, oh my God, he's so cute. I'm in love with him. And I was just like,
watch the trailer first. How could they make such a perfect person in a game?
So much so that you, like, drew him like a week later.
I did draw him, yeah.
I would draw him too, and then like start, you know, making yourself Mrs. Rima Ryder. Mrs. Rima
Ryder. Oh, you put Ryder the other in the head. No, don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it.
Mrs. Rima Scott Ryder. No, like, yeah, me too. They made, I mean, he's freaking dreamy. And like, I don't know how, like, talk about every man and every woman. I don't know if anyone says they don't think he's hot, I think they're lying.
Yeah, he's
I must admit, in that very same kind of moment we were watching the trailer for the first time. You kind of fawned over like, him. Oh, and then I was like, he's quite dashing, yes. Yeah, but it was the hair that struck out me, though. That was sculpted
hair. It's perfect!
Yeah.
They perfected future space gel. And also the Flowbee, because it's like perfectly faded on the sides, and he's got like that perfect little editorial, you know, moose floop.
Yes, he does. Yeah, just like
the perfect moose floop.
Thing is,
you know what?
He doesn't have helmet hair. That's the thing.
That's like, what I was gonna say. He
wears a helmet.
I don't know, Rima. We have the technology.
Oh, I know.
I will be playing. Maybe it's like memory foamed or like molded, so like inside the helmet there's like this perfect cutout for his stupid hair.
I think it's just a bigger compartment at the top. There's just a lot more space up there.
We've established that probably Scott Ryder is going to be the one that's the more primp and more vain one of the twins.
Maybe. Yeah, I mean, I hope they've thought of everything, and I hope that his hair gets messed up in combat or gets messed up in bed or something, because I swear to God, if we see like a morning after shot and his hair is still perfect, that is as garbagey as like every time you watch a film or TV show and they wake up and the woman's in full makeup. Stupid garbage, not real. Like, she's like, oh, I just woke up, and my eyelashes are on.
It's like a scene from Bridesmaid, isn't it? When she gets up and she goes to the bathroom and she like puts the makeup on just to impress him and gets back into bed. And
you're like, yeah, it's like that. No. That's actually Scott Ryder. He gets up before he covers makeup to do his hair.
Oh, dear. Well, that is the end of our questions. So,
that is it.
Yeah. So, Fryda, before we let you go, is there anything else you'd like to say to our followers and our subscribers?
Thank you for having me and my nonsense in your very lovey-dovey XTC-filled universe where everyone is just so incredibly nice and welcoming and warm and lovely, and I hope you enjoy the game as much as I have enjoyed working on it. It's definitely an experience that I will not forget because it's never-ending. Also, and I think I like, and I also noticed just the In the same way that, like, you know, you guys and I have waxed on about stuff like Bioshock Infinite and other games that just sort of, like, make this lasting impact on you, regardless of how you feel about how the story's written or whatever, I know this game is going to have a lasting impact on you just because of your emotional connection to the universe. So I hope you enjoy the ride.
I'm sure we will.
Just
sure
makes us want it there a little bit more now.
Yes, I know. Next year can come soon enough.
Yeah, pretty much. Exactly. Yeah. but that's it. So, Fryda, thank you very much for coming on nearly 2 hours and waxing lyrical with us while we fangirl away. And for anyone listening, thank you for listening and for watching. As always, you can subscribe to the channel to stay up to date on all things Mass Effect, and you can help the channel to grow by sharing the video too. Thank you for listening and for watching once again. We'll see you all very soon.